So here with Nicola Caines, who is the editor of the Brighton Indy, Brighton Hove independent newspaper, and we are back. I hope you had a good holiday, Nicola. It's all going on now, isn't it, in the city? And we're starting off the marathon. That's back finally after, I think, 2 year kind of pause there due to the pandemic. And it's going to be hot weather, so I'm a bit worried about the runners. My brother's running in it, but it's going to be a lot of people out and on the trail as well, not on the course.
Yeah, it's really exciting. Since the Brighton Indy's been back, this is our first Brighton Marathon again to be able to cover. So we're quite excited about it. Just such a big event for the city, isn't it? And as well as all the serious runners out there that are going to try and get some good times, there's absolutely loads of people doing it for charities, isn't there? Lots of our local charities really kind of rely on events like this. And yeah, in this week's paper, I've been chatting to some of the runners who are doing it for charities. So we've got people doing it for the Rocking Horse charity, which is the one that supports the hospital, and in particular the special baby unit up at our hospital in Brighton. And then Albion in the Community, which is another great kind of local charity. They've got people running for them. And yeah, it's really nice, all these people doing something, well, very energetic, but also for such a great cause. So we'll be featuring a lot of them, giving them some nice publicity this week, as well as a bit of kind of info on the marathon itself, the route, and all of that stuff. And yeah, I'm hoping to get down there myself and see some of the people at the finish line. So yeah, if you see me there, say hello. And but also anyone who's taking part, if you want to send us your pictures, during the race, like you running and finishing the race, and tell us a bit about who you run for and stuff, that would be amazing. So yeah, please, anyone wants to email me pictures and information about that, I'd love to see it.
And what's the email address for that?
Yeah, if they send it to our general one, which is news@brightonandhoveindependent.co.uk. That'd be brilliant.
And it's going to be
good luck to everyone.
Yeah, exactly. And it's I know my brother's running for the Martless Hospice. So, I mean, there's always these charities that people are running for. They need the money as well. That's the bottom line as well, don't they? They need funding. So
yeah, obviously with lockdown, lots of fundraising events had to be cancelled, didn't they, and stuff. So yeah, I think it'll be a real, real good boost to lots of local charities, which is always a good thing.
Yeah, exactly. And the route's bigger than what you think, isn't it? It goes all the way to Salt Dean, I think. And so it's a good old course, that. It's a massive trek, isn't it? And
I couldn't do it.
Yeah, exactly. I think what's good about it this year, though, is that I think we'll get a good turnout of people cheering them on. I think we're going to get a big crowd in the city centre for that. So looking forward to that. What next thing, top pet competition. What's all that about? Because I know that we've spoken about it before.
You've
had a big response, haven't you? And now you're going to be in next week's newspaper, you're going to be publishing the kind of the entry, the candidates.
Yeah, so we thought, as we know, that Brighton and Hove and Portslade are kind of patches full of animal lovers. And we just love it when people share their kind of pictures with us and stuff. And we thought we'd ask people to send us pictures of their pet. And we teamed up with RSPCA Brighton, and they agreed to do a lovely hamper for the winning pet. And yeah, we had a slow start with the entries, actually. And I was thinking, come on, send us your pets. But yeah, we give it a final kind of push this week to say, get your last entries in. And we've had absolutely loads come in. So yeah, I'm in the process of creating pages full of animal pictures. And then we'll be asking people to vote which one they think should be the top pet. And then obviously we'll announce the winner and organise their prize. So yeah, it's just a bit of fun. And yeah, just promoting that our city is full of all animal lovers. And yeah, it's really nice and really cute pictures. So be good.
Yeah, exactly. What about Pier Fest? I know that... you're going to be promoting a bit of the stuff that's going on at the Pier Fest. That's the, at the moment, it's been this month. We've had Bootleg Beatles on the end of the Pier Horatio's bar on Sunday. We've also had some folk music on there as well. we've got some other gigs going on in October.
Yes.
Brighton Palace Pier, it's a good venue to host an event, isn't it? To host a gig.
Oh, gosh. It's brilliant, isn't it? So obviously there's that loads of events going on now in our city, which is brilliant to see. But yeah, the pier, the Palace Pier, it's fantastic, especially on a sunny day, sunny evening. Yeah, like you said, there's already been some really popular events down there, the Bootleg Beatles, and lots more to come. And we've got a nice big preview of what you can see there over the coming weeks. And yeah, it is lovely, isn't it, on the pier, watching the sunset while some of these kind of events are going on, and music. It's brilliant. It's perfect kind of summer entertainment, isn't it? So yeah, if people want to know about that, yeah, we'll have a nice kind of spread on that and what's going on in this week's paper.
Brilliant. And they can get it, obviously, it comes out, get it from Friday, can't you, this week's newspaper, and it's available in shops, £1 in over 200 outlets.
Yeah, so it's out every Friday, but it's a weekly paper. So if you don't get it on the Friday, you can still get it after that. And yeah, £1 for the week. But if you like it, there's also vouchers inside, and you can get your next copy for half the price, 50 pence. And you can also sign up to get the Brighton Indy delivered to your house as well. So yeah, lots of ways to get it. There's no excuse. So get your copy.
Yeah. From the pier to the cycle lanes, and it's not the one along Seafront. We're talking about the one along Old Shoreham Road. It's been a long running saga, and it's gonna shortly come to a close, isn't it? Because it is gonna finally get removed, the cycle lane along Old Shoreham Road.
Yeah, as you say, it's been a long kind of running one. That so obviously as part of during the lockdown, there was kind of lots of schemes, wasn't there, to encourage people to get out and use kind of sustainable travel and get on their bikes. And that is obviously a real positive, isn't it? Encouraging people to leave the car at home, get out on your bike. Unfortunately, the cycle lane in Old Shoreham Road didn't get the best response, mainly from kind of motorists who were a bit kind of frustrated that it was actually creating more traffic because it used a whole lane of the carriageway. So yeah, it was a tricky one because the idea behind it is good, but lots of people were not happy about it. And eventually it was voted through, wasn't it, by councillors to remove it back in August. And yeah, now they've been pushing for it to actually be removed, and that starts on Monday next week. So yeah, it's gonna go.
Yeah, exactly. And the thing with cycle lanes, it was almost, it was kind of putting cyclists and other road users, drivers, pedestrians, kind of pitting them against each other. So it was kind of, it wasn't a good advertisement for cycle lanes, because there are some really good cycle lanes in the city, isn't there? And I know the ones down the seafront are widely used, rather whereas the ones in Old Shoreham Road, maybe not so much.
Yeah, as I say, it's a shame because it's the idea is right, isn't it?
Yeah.
That it just didn't quite work, that one. But yeah, the one on in the seafront, along the seafront into the city, that one's worked really well. So that's great.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Green spaces in Hove. We're going to kind of recreate some of the nice green spaces that are in Hove. Tell us a bit about that. I know it's an initiative that's going on at the moment.
Yeah, this is a council thing. It's between the Hove Lagoon and King Alfred Leisure Centre. Yep. So the kind of bits of green area along. Yeah, they're looking at kind of, yeah, creating some nice kind of green areas there to encourage kind of a bit of biodiversity, all of that kind of stuff, which is all really good. But they've launched a consultation. They want to hear kind of views of residents, what they think about it, what they'd like to see there. Yeah, I think it'll be good. I mean, I think a lot of that area isn't that well used, is it? So it's be nice to kind of make something of it. And yeah, lots of potential there. So you can find out details about that in this week's paper and how to kind of share your views with the council, basically.
Yeah, and I think, I mean, I've spoken to Councillor Robert Nemeth and Councillor Gary Peltz have done about this, as well as others in the past. And the big issue here, I think, is that people don't often go past the kind of King Alfred area. They won't go along to, say, Hove Lagoon. They'll just stop at the King Alfred if they're walking along the promenade and head back into the centre of the city. So I think the council are keen to get people to get walking a lot more down that promenade on the seafront towards Hove Lagoon to kind of spread everyone out.
Yeah, I mean, we've got Rockwater there now, haven't we? And that seems to be quite popular, attracting people along there. And obviously, when the circus comes, that's kind of on the green there, isn't it? So yeah, I think, I think it's when I go down there, it's normally quite busy on a sunny day.
Yeah, exactly. All right, I'm going to leave it there for the first half. Join us for the second half. I'll be speaking a lot more to Nicola Caines, editor of the Brighton Indy newspaper, about local issues. Join us then. So back here for the second half of The Vote with Nicola Caines, editor of the Brighton Indy newspaper, out every week on a Friday. It's £1, a bargain. And can talk about speed trials now, Nicola, because they were, I didn't get to go down there, and I know a lot of people did go down. I was writing a dissertation. I do regret that, because it looked really great, and it's good to see Madeira Drive not just used for cycling but used for other events as well. It's going to be used for the marathon, as we know, at the weekend. It was used for the speed trials last weekend, and I think we've had some other vehicle rallies down there in weeks gone by as well, so it's been
Yeah, that's true. And we've also got another veteran car one, haven't we, in November. Yeah. So you're right. It's nice. And I didn't get to go down there either because I was away. But seeing the pictures, it really did look fantastic the way the cars were kind of going along there. And it looked like a real lovely space for that type of event, didn't it? So, yeah, we were lucky that we had a photographer there, took lots of pictures, which we got on to our website, but we'll also use a selection of those in the newspaper. The feedback has been great, that it was just a fantastic event. Lots of enthusiasts out there watching, and it's just another event that's been able to return now, which is great. Obviously, unfortunately, they didn't have the motorbike part though this time, did they? Because it was deemed that although we think it does look great down there, the surfaces, and there was a few issues that they said it wasn't safe enough for the motorbikes, unfortunately. So that was a shame. But overall, really kind of big success. And we'll have some nice pictures from that in the Brighton Indy.
Brilliant, yeah, and it did look great, speed trials, and the weather was great, and what was not to like? It was, it's great. Brighton's been really busy. I know the Warren has finished now as well, the Warren by the Sea. That's been packed up with the iconic kind of plane there that they had in the, on the seafront. But, it's a great time to be in Brighton at the moment. It's busy, isn't it? It's hot and it's busy.
Whew, yeah, I mean, that's perfect for Brighton, isn't it? It's Yeah, you'll see the traffic coming into Brighton at the weekends to take advantage of this. And that's great news for all of our businesses and venues. Yeah. And yeah, although the Warren part has shut up, the Theatre Royal is now kind of open again. I know that this week they've got Dirty Dancing there. So, yeah, they've got a great, great lineup of shows at the Theatre Royal. So hopefully people will enjoy getting back to the theatre and supporting that as well. And then I think it's not long until the Brighton Centre is back up and running as well. Yep. And that's why they obviously moved the vaccination centre, didn't they, away from the Brighton Centre, so that could reopen and get some good kind of shows and bit of music there. So, yeah, it's all opening back up, and Brighton's getting busy again. And yeah, although for some of us we might think, it's busy, but it's great, isn't it? It's good to see, really positive.
Yeah, I mean, are you covering the vaccination protests? I mean, I was there going to Marks and Spencer, actually, not the protest, but I mean, a few protests, isn't there, in the city by the anti-vaxxers.
It's they're doing what they're doing, and lots of people have got different opinions, haven't they?
Yeah.
But we've been quite supportive at the Brighton Indy of the kind of vaccination rollout. And yeah, we've been trying to work with the council to promote that and get as many people vaccinated as possible. The science says it helps, doesn't it? So yeah, fingers crossed. And yeah, I think we're moving in the right direction now, aren't we, with the number of cases. And although the numbers can seem high, it's that important figure that we've spoken about before, the number of people that are unfortunately losing their lives, that that has drastically decreased. So that's got to be good.
Yeah, on to the football, the Amex Stadium. I know you're going to be, or your family's going to be travelling to the Brentford game, and I'm going to the Brentford game, away game, second away game of the season. It's back up and running again, football, after the international break. So I know we've got to wait a while to the middle of the month to see Leicester City at the Amex, and then we've got Arsenal. But Brighton over Albion at the moment in, top half of the table, 6 points from three games. Not too bad, is it?
Yeah, I won't pretend that I'm the expert in my family, but yeah, we're a big family of Brighton fans, and yeah, lots of good games ahead to look forward to. Just hope that they can keep performing. Started the season well, didn't they? Little bit of a hiccup, but yeah, I think it's another real positive, isn't it? And getting people back at the Amex, and the atmosphere there is just fantastic on a match day, isn't it? So, yeah, and they obviously have had a women's game as well, didn't they, last week? And so it's great to see people out supporting that as well. Yeah, really good. But in the Brighton Indy, again, I'm not the expert, but our sports editor, Darren, is. And he produces 12 pages every week about the Albion. Lots of kind of looking ahead to the next game, kind of analysing the last match, all the transfer news in there, and then lots and lots of kind of columns, people sharing their opinions about the team and everything that's going on. So if you are an Albion fan, it is a really good read in the Indy.
Yeah, and the women, yeah, they did well, the women's team. They won 2-0 in that game. So, the football, it's good with the football. And, I mean, talking to other exercise, I know there's been a soulful Saturday, which took place. And Graham Potter, the Albion manager, was there as well. And that was near Glebe Villas.
Yeah, so this was an event at the weekend. It was for the Off the Fence charity, which is a Brighton charity for the homeless and vulnerable people in the city. So really good cause. And recently Graham Potter, the Brighton manager, and his wife Rachel became patrons of the charity. And this was the first event organised by Rachel Potter, who is a Pilates teacher. And she decided to hold this soulful Saturday event. And it included Pilates and then a kind of meditation session and a lovely kind of healthy brunch. And they also had kind of raffles on the day. And yeah, as you said, Graham Potter actually popped along as well and helped out. And it was really popular. Yeah, I think they've done an online auction as well. And in total, from like the ticket sales, the raffle and the online auction, they're looking at having raised about £5,000. So yeah, really good, positive kind of thing. And yeah, it sounded nice. I was away, unfortunately. Yeah. Wouldn't have minded a bit of Pilates and a nice brunch. But yeah, another really good event. And that's what we're about at the Brighton Indy. If people have got kind of charity events, please let us know, because we really want to support all of our local charities and events and everything. So yeah, if you've got something like that, let us know and we'll get you some publicity and hopefully promote it.
Yeah, and once again, that email address that people contact you by, it's the news.
Yeah, if you've got anything like that, please email it to news@brightonandhoveindependent.co.uk. And any pictures and information you can send over, and we'll do the rest.
Yep, and obviously newspaper, it's available every Friday. It's a weekly newspaper, £1 as well, should say that. What else are you looking forward to then between now and the rest of the year? I mean, maybe, you know, you were talking about the Theatre Royal coming back, the Brighton Dome, the Brighton Centre. There's going to be a lot of events taking place in the city. So it's worth getting a newspaper just for the events listings, really, because they are brilliant.
Yeah, again, that's an area we've wanted to focus on, is lots of information on what's happening. It's quite nice to kind of come out on a Friday and we can tell people what's happening that weekend and the week ahead.
Yeah.
So we're hopefully we're providing a nice little service for people. Local people can pick it up, see what's been happening, what's happening going ahead, theatre, but also things for families to do. We, as I say, we've got a real focus on that, as well as mixing that in with all of the latest news, all the council stuff, all the sports, puzzles, food. We've got recipes in there. Charities, like I said, a bit of everything, really. So yeah, we hope people like it.
Plus the nostalgia. What's coming up on the nostalgia pages? What were you covering?
I can't even tell you that yet this week, because I don't know what it is just yet. But we get that provided by the lovely people at the pavilion and museums, and they have a look in their archives for us, and they dig out something really interesting about the past in Brighton and Hove. And we've had lots of lovely things on there about different parts of the pavilion and the building there. And yeah, lots of kind of looking back on events from a long time ago. So yeah, we kind of have lots of lovely people that help us out with some of our content and columns. And we couldn't do it without them. But it means we get some really good kind of content from all different kind of places. And obviously we like working with you guys as well at Latest TV, and you help us out and we can help promote each other's events and stuff. So yeah, it's all about working together. So if anyone's out there's got something they want.
Yeah, brilliant. And we're going to leave it there. So that's Nicola Caines, editor of the Brighton Indy.
Thanks, Mark.
Thanks a lot, Nicola.